is May 12, 2003, and this is the beginning of an interview with Dallas Jackson at my home at 406 East Wiley Street in Marion, Indiana. Mr. Jackson is 55 years old, being born on June 14, 1947. My name is Chelsea Patterson, and I'll be the interviewer. Dallas Jackson is my mom's coworker and friend. Mr. Jackson, could you state for the recording what war and branch of service you served in?
I was in the Vietnam service, United States Army, from 1965 to 1967.
What was your rank?
I was a Sergeant D5 when I got out.
And where'd you serve?
Oh, several locations in Vietnam. We landed in Cam Ranh Bay in June of 1966 and set up a base camp. We were there about 3 weeks. We went to Thuy Hoa, which was south, about 50 miles. We set up another base camp. From there, we went to Phan Rang, another 80 miles north, getting closer to the DMZ. We left the main battalion and our support units there, and we proceeded on to Pantiat. And this was in August, we arrived at Pantiat. That was on the South China Sea.
Were you drafted or did you enlist?
I volunteered for the draft.
Volunteered?
Only difference between that and enlisting, it was only 2 years. If I had enlisted, it'd been three.
Where were you living at the time?
Tipton, Indiana.
Tipton?
I was 18 at the time.
Why did you decide to join?
All my friends were either joining or getting ready to be drafted. So myself and two other friends just went to the Selective Service Board and put our names in.
Why did you pick the service branch you were in?
Again, a little peer pressure. And I had some friends that was already in the Army. They survived it, so I said, well, why not? So.
Do you recall your first days in service?
Hectic. I'm sure you've seen Platoon and several of these other films, you know, first day of boot camp, you know, all the drill sergeants yelling that. Just basically true, you know, getting off the bus. Yeah, I went to Fort Knox for basic training. We took a bus from Indianapolis. Arrived there probably around midnight. Everything yelling, you know, grabbing your stuff, trying to get in the barracks. It was, after the first couple of days, it left about. And then you kind of, if you wasn't yelled at, you wasn't doing anything. So something's wrong. So.
What'd it feel like?
Kind of, I like to say exciting, but, you was nervous, you know, and you're definitely getting in shape every time you turn around. I said, well, get down and give me 20, and we're talking about push-ups. Luckily, I was in shape back then, no problem. But, first night, you had fire watch, you know. You're there at midnight, and you're, aha, gonna go to sleep. You had to stay up. They had the old World War II wooden barracks, and someone had to be awake at all times, you know. So every 2 hours, you can trade it off. It's a good experience.
Tell me about some of your boot camp and training experiences.
Well, day one, like I said, we arrived about midnight. We was up, I'm pretty sure it's 5 o'clock. We were up, got shuttled to the mess hall, and we started learning how to run in formation and everything. First day we get our gear, get our cute little haircuts. After haircuts, we went to a big old warehouse. Lawrence. They just run you through there. They ask you what size, and you start telling them, they just throw you. This will fit. Okay. About the only thing it did fit was boots. Fit you two pair of boots. Four utility uniform. One dress green and one khaki uniform. And basically the first day, and then the second day was the battery test, IQ test, and general knowledge. And then that same day was back to the nations, shots and all sorts of good stuff.
Do you remember your instructors?
The Staff Sergeant Larry Anderson. He was from Kentucky. I ran into him later on in my career at Fort Dix, New Jersey. But, he was about the only one I remember. Basically, he was a good instructor. He had had prior Vietnam experience. He helped us quite a bit.
How did you get through it?
Day at a time. And it was December the 2nd when we got there. And we knew, like, in 2 weeks we'd get a little leave for Christmas, which we did. We got 3 days to go back home for Christmas. And it broke up monotony because of basic training was 8 weeks. So after less than 3 weeks, we were home for 3 days and went back and completed our basic training. Then after that, I had a 10-day leave, which I was looking forward to help you, you know. As long as you got a goal, you know, light at the end of the tunnel. So all in all, physical training, rifle training, CPR, NVC training, nuclear, biological, chemical. And back then, it was, we had quite a bit of first aid training, which my going father, I got out and went back in 73. And they did away with a lot of the first aid training. I don't know, but it was a learning experience, a lot of physical training, a lot of running.
What did you think when you heard you were going to the Vietnam War?
Really, in early 66, you didn't hear too much about it. Drill instructors kept, you know, reiterating that very possible 90% of us would be going. It wasn't upscale. There wasn't, you know, at one point there's 172,000 troops over there. That time, I think it's a little over 60,000. So, to go back from basic training, I was assigned to Port Carson, Colorado. And that is when I was standing out in formation. It was snowing, wind was blowing. And this first sergeant got a clipboard, and he comes out and says, "I'm looking for volunteers for some place called Vietnam." And I said, "Is it warm in Vietnam?" He said, "Definitely." I said, "Put my name down." And that's when it first dawned on me, he says, "Oh, I'm going to Vietnam." And I'm thinking, well, maybe 2 or 3 weeks I'll be over there. Mm-mm. I go from Fort Carson, Colorado to Fort Riley, Kansas. And it's colder at Fort Riley than what it was at Fort Carson. So I'm there like 3 months getting more training. And it was May 28, 1966, we got on a troop ship for Vietnam. So by the time I got on the ship, it was warm anyway. I was going, they got warm, so I got my wish. And we was on that troop ship for 22 days before we landed.
22 days?
Mm-hmm.
How was that?
That was crowded. We had like 10,000 people. had artillery units, infantry units, quartermaster battalion, and the MP unit, and first air cav. And interesting enough, I had two friends from Tipton on the ship that I ran across. One was artillery and one was infantry. But it was crowded, like I say. It wasn't bunk beds, it was three high little cloth bunks. And they got hot and crowded. About the second day out, we ran out of fresh water for showers. We used salt water for showers.
The second day you ran out of that?
Yeah, second or third. But then we started, seemed like every day we had oxtail stew for breakfast, but then it seemed like anyways. A couple of us guys got together and went down the hole of the ship and found some sea rations. We had some good sea rations. It broke the monotony. It was a long 22 days. We were glad to see land.
I bet. What were your viewpoints on the Vietnam War?
At that time, I was anxious to go. I think most part everybody on that troop ship was anxious to go and do their part. We were not misguided. A bunch of us were volunteers. At the time, we was thinking the same as the Korean War or World War II, you know. Little did we know, we'd end up being like scapegoats, you know. Had everybody back in the world, we called it protesting and burning flags. But at the time, anyway, we're still proud. I don't know any Vietnam vet that isn't, really.
Did you agree with the United States intervention in Vietnam?
again, back to that same answer. We was there, was behind our president and our government at the time. And then again, at the end of the, they're not calling it a war yet, but at the end, they let us down. They wouldn't let us win the war. It turned out to be political. Like President Johnson's wife owned one of three or four arms factory. She didn't want it to end, She was making money. But the war went through three presidents. We had Nixon, Johnson, and Ford. So that's the first in the history.
Do you think that the U.S. should have gone to war?
I think we should have went to win, not to make it a political war. We could have won numerous occasions. We had it won. They told us to back off. That's why we lost 58,000 troops.
You know why they just kept telling you to back off? It
comes down to politics. They was afraid to, Russia was already intervening. They was supplying arms. Of course, China was right there at the Chinese border, basically. And politicians were afraid of a full-scale war.
Where exactly in Vietnam did you go?
Like I say, we landed at Cam Ranh Bay, and basically the stations we set up, we were a support unit. I ended up at the 1st Air Cav at Phan Thiet. That was, I was there a little over 5 months, I believe. But we set up base camps for the combat troops, and they would more or less just follow us. And we'd set up like tent cities, and then the combat troops coming over get processed, get all their rations, arms, ammunition, and they go up do their own thing.
Do you remember driving and what it was like.
Oh, yeah. First day, it was, well, like we'd, no one had got mail for 22 days. And they had, about all day was mail call. They had a Red Cross tent set up, and they had ice cream. I mean, I hadn't had ice cream for a while. So that was good. And, of course, in down the road, we like beer tents, civilians, you know. That was my first taste of Vietnamese beer, Beer 33. They call it Bambi Ba, so you turn it up and you see little specks in it. Don't care if it's dirt or not, drank it anyway, but it turns out it was pieces of rice, you know. They made rice wine, they made rice beer. Anything you wanted out of rice, you could get. But anyway, after eating like a half a gallon of ice cream, I drink two or three beers, and I get an upset tummy. I'm sick for the rest of the day and night. But, then we get unloaded, and we get our battalion area secured right on the beach, right off the beach. Anyway. Then we get a couple days R&R there. On the beach. This one guy from Missouri, last name was Austin. Red haired and light complexion. He got burnt. I mean, they was going to court martial. He blistered up his back. But he was really our first casualty. He couldn't hardly move, get in his clothes or anything. On the ship also, I'd won a 8mm camera, a video camera, movie camera, and I'd left it with him, the guard, along my wallet and everything. And well, he went to sleep, and that's why he got burnt so bad. And they stole my camera and wallet, and little rugrats running up and down the beaches, they'd steal anything. What they couldn't find from you. But I don't know. Had a bunch of mail. Had a Dear John letter waiting for me. Karen Ketchum. Love my life. And I knew her like a month before I went in. She threw me over the time I landed. It was, say, it's good to get off that ship. And the countryside was pretty. Right there on the beach in the South China Sea. And a lot of ships in the harbor. It's really nice to eat.
What was your job assignment?
That varied. At the time, going through basic, fractured both my heels, took me out of a combat role, couldn't be a foot soldier. Ended up, when I first got there, I was a truck driver. Hauling supplies all around and running our convoys back and forth. At one time, I was helping to set up the water purification stations, you know, finding fresh water and land right off the beaches. And we'd fill like big old 5,000 gallon drums of fresh water and get it in there for the troops. From there, I went to grade registration. What I did with the 1st Cav Division. It's for the fun, kind of went out of it. But we would, sometimes we would retrieve bodies, other times they would send them in to us. We'd clean them up, prep them. We had our own refrigeration unit. We'd throw them in the back, get so many, we'd ship them. Saigon with ID and ship them home. But that was about the first part of it. As far as seeing a whole bunch of action, we were attacked occasionally, nothing serious. A few mortar rounds, a few sniper stuff. I didn't have it bad like the ground pounders did. They went out looking for it. I'm stationary, so Wasn't too bad. Had a lot of friends with that refrigerated truck, though. They wanted to keep their beer cold. Of course, I drank a few of them, too.
There weren't many casualties in your unit then?
As far as the unit went that I went over with, we got pretty well dispersed. There was enough me and 12 other people there. Many of had out of us 13 when we lost two. But that was, like I say, mortar and sniper attacks that came after us. We didn't do any ground beating or anything. And I made a few friends there at the 1st Cav, especially Combat Engineer Battalion. I lost three good friends on one mission. They were minesweeping. Gary Dusso from Flint, Michigan was one of them. Two other guys. So really, didn't make too many friends with the 1st Cav. Because they kept rotating all the time. I saw a lot of bodies, but fortunately I didn't know about it.
Tell me about a couple of your most memorable experiences.
I didn't mention that. One time I had to go to the train. I was running low on parts for my generators. They needed updated, so I get to go to the train for a couple of days, you know, and that's just like a vacation. It's a large city there. It's also in South China Sea. And I go bar hopping while I'm there, and I run up on a guy from Tipton, Indiana, Mike Johnson. He's stationed in the train. He said, come on, I'll show you where to go and all this, you know. So I end up staying 3 days. But we had a good visit, you know. Finally got back. And evidently no one was worried about me. They was worried about the parts. So I got the parts back. That was one time. And then I got me a pet duck. Little bitty duck. And just kidding around like, you know, 18-year-olds do. I got a bottle of rice wine, didn't you? Rice brandy. And I poured a little cup for him. And he just drank it all up. Then he started staggering down and fell over dead. I don't know. You know, that's not really funny, but that was about the only pet I had while I was over there. Other guys had a couple of little monkeys. They're not really good pets in the wild. It was hard to contain, and they would get into their supplies and go to the bathroom on them. So they didn't last long either. They'd keep them a few days and get rid of them. That and my ice cream and beer trying to mix, that wasn't too good. I can remember except, getting ready to come home. That was a good experience. We ended up, we were going to convoy back to base camp, and we couldn't get through. Charlie had the road. We couldn't use the road, Highway 1, so they had to bring in the choppers and got us all back to base camp. And that was another good time. I was glad to see the choppers, 1st Cav. Good unit.
Were you awarded any medals or citations?
Oh, yeah. Of course, everyone got the National Defense Service Medal. I got the Vietnamese Service Medal, the Vietnamese Combat Medal. Vietnamese cross of gallantry with palm. Two citations for Vietnam, counteroffensive and counteroffensive two. Two overseas bars, the Army Commendation Medal, and Good Conduct Medal. Don't forget that one. That's about it. Nothing spectacular like the two I got for the counteroffensive. We just happened to be there with the first cab when they hit, like I said, when they attacked us. So the first cab had to go back after them, so it's called offensive. And I just happened to be assigned to them at the time. And the Vietnamese Cross of Gallantry, that was another attack. And that was a probing action, we found out. Seeing how far inland they could get. It came with the sand pans, the little round boats. I don't know if you're familiar with them or not, but they came at night and beached and hit us early in the morning. And again, first cab came through. Took care of us. So we all got that also.
How'd you stay in touch with your family?
Pretty easy. Once we got set up at Fantaed after Alba moving, had pretty regular mail calls, probably twice a week. And of course, that time when all mail was free, we never used stamps. Just put an EPO number on there, and mail service got pretty good. And they're steady. As far as like. Now they go to combat with their cell phones and everything, and never had any phone contact or anything. But after I was there 7 months, I got R&R for a wife, went to Honolulu for 7 days, and made phone calls. Other than that, I'd say mail service was good.
What was the food like?
The food is mainly sea rations, which you got to tolerate, and you found ways to fix it up. You could heat up your beanie weenies, and you had your spiced beef, and, chicken noodles, and you find on economy there. I used some cucumbers and tomatoes and mixed it all together and had your gumbo and French bread, that long, hard French bread that the French left when they was there. You know, the French got kicked out in 54. But that's a different story. But you didn't want to eat nothing on the economy. You know, like a restaurant or anything, that was a no. Spam, you get spam. They came in like 5 pound tins. And you got to like that. I still eat that. It's good. holidays, Christmas, Thanksgiving, I always managed to have a good meal.
That wasn't too bad.
Yeah. You say you learned to adjust. You know, even. And stop to think about it. The POWs, you know, some of them, what, 9 years in captivity, and they learn to adapt, you know, to a little broth and rice every once in a while. Call it mind over matter, or the need for survival, you know, like guy cutting his arm up, come down to it, you'll find a way. Not always easier, but you want.
Did you have plenty of supplies?
Yeah. It goes with the food, you know. Like I say, the original company I was with was 96th Quartermaster Battalion. So we had had a direct line to them once we was up there. And the first cab had their own engineer and quartermaster battalion. And being combat unit, they had first dibs on everything. And then again, on with them, we had no real supply problems. But also, I think it was twice, maybe three times a month, they would fly in cigarettes and beer for the troops. You know, about everybody got a carton of cigarettes and six pack, sometimes 12 pack of beer. But that was back when it was steel cans, and they'd rust, and they get to us and be all rusty, you know. I'd be still precious. And like I say, we'd get Falstaff beer, Sterling, Reinholdt. It's a beer from the East Coast up around New Jersey. And Mucky Moon get Budweiser. You know, they fight over Budweiser. And the same way with cigarettes. Most people wanted filter cigarettes. And that's where I picked up the habit of smoking Pall Mall, where that was, because no one else wanted them. Mm-hmm. So I always had plenty of cigarettes. And candy bars occasionally end up with cases of candy bar. I don't know if somebody in Saigon didn't want them or something, we'd end up with them. But you know, it's a good treat, you know. But, you know, unexpected, you know, stuff you wouldn't think of. You know, so, there's a candy bar. So, looked that pretty good.
Did you feel any pressure or stress in your day?
No, not really. Like everybody else, you was looking at the calendar, you was counting your days off, you try to keep abreast of what was going on around you, you know, as far as the combat role, and keep wanting to hear something from the politicians. Yeah, we're going to end this war, you know, next month or so, you know. Like great expectations. You want it to be over, but you don't want it to end like it did. You know? But, like to have a stalemate for a truce, even like Vietnam or Korea, which we never did.
Did you expect it to end like that? Or did you expect to win?
You know, I expected to win. We marched into Berlin. You know? We wanted to go to Hanau. You know? Mm-hmm. But it didn't happen that way.
Were you anxious to go home, or did you want to stay longer?
Oh, yeah. Like I said, I was counting days on the calendar like we all were. But then again, we all, you know, at the end of it, were disappointed. You know. Of course, I'd been out. Almost 5 years when it didn't. Official pull out of Saigon was May of 1973. One of the last Americans left of Saigon. And I came back home in May of 67. So there was a lot of combat after that. A lot of people.
Did you do anything for good luck?
No, I can't remember anything in particular. I wasn't overly religious until the firing started. And that adage, somebody said, there's never an atheist in a foxhole. When they're shooting at you, everybody's praying to God. You know? So, no atheists when you're getting fired at. Like I say, luckily I didn't see that often. But for good luck, no, I can't remember any good luck charm. I did have a $2.98 PX watch that I wore all the time I was over there, and got on the airplane coming back. We flew back, luckily. And just got up in the air and then it exploded. the springs and everything just came out.
Exploded?
Yeah, the dial, you know, it was weird. They can't buy a good watch these days, you know. But I remember I bought it for $298 in Fortnite Peak. And it lasted all that time. I guess the air pressure got it when it was taken on. Maybe that's a good like watch. Lasted till I got on the plane.
How do people entertain themselves?
Like I say, occasionally we wasn't too far from the village. And I made a couple friends there at Fantiette. One of them were dad on the little bar we went to. Her name was Mai, M-A-I. She was a French Vietnamese, probably 17 or 18. Couldn't speak real good English. She was a pretty girl. I had a photo of her and I got lost in my divorce also. So. But we would go to the village occasionally. They had barbers there. We'd get haircuts, photography. You could get pictures taken. And of course, you had bar girl, no problem. You know, it was prostitution was rampant. You know, they would sell their daughters, give their daughters away. You know, for like $2 or $3. The unit currency was piastres. It was 100 piastres to $1 American. Like you could find your girl for $2 or $3. It was that bad at that time. Like I say, that was early stages. So understand later on the build up, the prices got higher. So, you know, supply and demand. I don't know. Like the entertainment occasionally. You know, a couple times a month in the village. Even the combat troops would come back. The longest they would be out would be 7 days. Time that would be the longest. They'd come back in, go to the village, and or just lay around, drink a few American beers, write letters. Occasionally they would have American films up at their battalion headquarters.
Were there any entertainers there?
Not in our area. Bob Hope and his troop would hit the bigger areas, Nha Trang, Van Tau, Saigon, away up north. Very seldom they would get that deep in the field.
What
did
you do when you were on leave?
Drank. Yeah, when I got back, well, officially the only leave I had was at 7 day R&R. Called home about every day. Didn't really do all that much sightseeing. Went to a couple shows there, country and western shows in the way. Hated to get back on the plane and go back to Vietnam. We stopped at the Philippines on the way back for a fuel stop or something. And all of us got off and they had duty-free booze there, whiskey or whatever. You get like a gallon for $1.90, I believe it was. And we stocked up about all we could carry and took back with us. Actually, that's the only leave I got while I was over there. When I returned to the States, I had 30-day leave before I had to report to Fort Dix, New Jersey. I had 6 months left in the Army. So in that 30 days, I got me a car, 1961 Chevy. went fishing at times of day. That is.
Do you recall any particularly humorous or unusual in this event?
Oh, other than my duck dying?
Yeah.
Well, I told you about on the ship, I won that movie camera playing bingo. And a couple of the sailors didn't like it, so we got in a little scuffle with them. And I ended up on KP. I don't know if you call that humorous or not, but I got on KP, got in a fight, and ended up with the camera getting stolen. So it wasn't for me to make a documentary of Vietnam. But. And it was kind of funny when the old boy got sunburned.
Did you or your friends ever play pranks on anyone?
Yeah. We'd be on guard duty down guarding our equipment right off the beach. And occasionally they'd have hot food up at the mess tent at the 1st Cav headquarters. And we'd whoever's on guard, did he ask somebody to bring him a sandwich or something, you know? But one guy would never do it, you know, he'd be too busy or if he get or something, you know, so somebody's in the foxhole and he might get nothing to eat. So this guy was on guard duty one day. Oh, would you guys bring me a sandwich? Yep. Sure will. On the side of the road there's a dead chicken. We got his paper plates, plugged that chicken, put it between the plates. Here's your sandwich. He started cussing. But from then on, we was on guard duty, he'd bring us up to eat. So he got the picture. He didn't think it was too funny. But chicken stunk too. Mentioned the pork and beans.
Oh, no, go ahead.
Oh, no. I told you about the, you know, prostitution and people selling their daughters and everything. I was on a supply run in a little deuce and a half truck. And I had my, we had twin 50s on the top of it, the machine guns on each side. Anyway, stopped at this little village. We had extra supplies we were authorized to give away, you know, to the needy there in Vietnam. And we had these big old cans of pork and beans. You know? So I go inside and this mama-san asked me if I wanted to be with her daughter, you know? I said, no, no fiesta, no can do, no boom boom. He says, he pointing up my pork and beans. I said, ah, yeah, here were pork and beans. So me and baby sign, you know, we go do what baby signs do, you know. And we come out, and the big can of pork and beans already been eaten. I mean, they ate it all. Didn't leave her one bean. So I find her some chewing gum and some sea rations to give her. I don't know if she got them or not, but it was kind of funny.
Do you have any photographs?
That was misplaced in my divorce also. I got a few that they're floating around.
Do Do you remember the day your service ended?
December 1st, 1967, first time. That was at Fort Dix, New Jersey. Yeah, I got to Fort Dix, New Jersey, and they put me in the MP, so I was an MP when I got out. So, I'm sure you don't remember the race riots. Summer 67 in Newark, New Jersey. We got fast training on riot control. Gave us rubber bullets, which we weren't allowed to shoot, and shields. They sent us to Newark, New Jersey to quell the riots after I'd been across the ocean for a year. And so yeah, it was a bad point about that war also. We had the race riots going on. We had the demonstrators against the war, burning flags. We had Jane Fonda doing the hen out with the enemy. As a bummer coming back and having to face that. You know, like this war going on now, everybody's getting welcome home. All the goodies, you know, yellow ribbons, and what we had, people burning flags, spitting on your baby killers. It was unreal. And then, like I say, then I get thrown in the race riots in Newark, New Jersey. One time I even volunteered to go back to Vietnam.
That's not bad.
Yep. That's where the pressure and stress came. Then I got off the streets of Newark, and they put me a stockade duty. 12 hours on, 12 hours off, 7 days a week. Until I got out, you know. And I had a captain, 532nd MP, wouldn't sign my paperwork. Because I would have had to re-enlist and then volunteer for Vietnam. He wouldn't sign it. Because he didn't like it.
Like you?
Nope.
Why not?
He thought I was prejudiced.
Why do you think that?
Because he was black. And I made a statement, it's a damn shame I'm Vietnam fighting, and I come over here and fight my own people. Anyway, we didn't get along.
What did you do in the days and weeks after?
For the next couple of months, just enjoyed life. Did a lot of visiting, traveled around a little bit. After a couple of months, I found me a job at Chrysler in Kokomo. I got almost 90 days in and got laid off. And after that, I started bartending there in Tipton right before I was 21. And I bartended about 3 years. Got married. Decided to go back to Army, May of 73. I was in the Army from 73 to 1980.
Were you still married when you went back?
Yeah.
Does that affect your marriage any?
They're to last. I had just got back. Well, she went to Germany with me. We spent 3 years in Germany, came back, and was assigned to Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri. Which wasn't bad. We were there 2 years almost. I come down on orders to go back to Germany. And I was up for re-enlistment, and I was having family problems. So November 1980, I got out of the Army and got divorced the same month.
You were in Germany for 3 years? Can you speak German then?
Nix freaking she Dutch.
Did you understand anything?
Ein dear bitte. Confritz mit Jägersnitz. Ein Gift.
What did you just say?
I said French fries and Jägerschnitzel with a beer. Yeah, Pomfret is French fries.
What did you go on to do as a career after the war?
Basically, I think most of the time was bartending. Until the time I went back in, and I planned on making Army a career, which I pretty much did. I'm drawing disability from a prior injury, small disability. And after I got out in 80, I went on to work at auto parts stores. That was pretty interesting. Service manager at auto dealerships. I was an encyclopedia salesman. Didn't sell any. I just worked at that a couple of weeks. Worked in the oil field in Oklahoma. Got in security in 1993. Been in that ever since. Started off with Burns and then on to Pinkerton. What I'm doing right now.
From what injury were you getting disability from?
My feet, my fracture.
Was it from the war or just?
No, basic training.
Oh, training?
Mm-hmm. That might have been a blessing in disguise. Like I said, I couldn't be in active combat. So. I was a truck driver, an MVN, gray registration, everything.
Did you join a veterans organization?
Yeah, I belong to the VFW and American Legion. Keep saying I'm going to join the DAV, Disabled American Veterans. I haven't got around to that yet.
What kind of activities does your post association have? Okay. There we go.
The American Legion sponsors the Little League baseball team in Tipton County. We have our poppy sales at the Legion, whichever post it is, and the VFW. Any veteran dies in Tipton County or surrounding counties, we'll give them a military funeral. Myself and 12 others. From the President and Congress of the United States, present the flag and give them 21 guns to always enjoy doing that. Until they play taps on that tap still gets me every time.
Did your military experience influence your thinking about war or the military in general?
Kind of gave me a bad taste with politicians. Now, I'm saying we're over there 170,000 strong, and they're saying, yeah, we're pulling troops out, so we got this war won. Yeah. And come find out in all the history books that we lost that war, which in my mind and every veteran's mind, we didn't lose that war. Politicians gave that war away. Like I said before, we want the war. You can't beat the White House. Had your ambassador to Saigon, one in Washington, D.C., drinking coffee and tea, you know. So they're one to call the shots. So we were just puppets.
Did you attend any
reunions? No. That's funny. Like I said, there's 13 of us pretty well side by side there for the last 6 months, and we just fell out of touch. Of course, at the time, departure, oh yeah, we're going to keep in touch once a year, you know, we're going to party. Never happened. Couldn't tell you where any of them's at, right?
None of them?
No contact or nothing.
How did your service and experiences affect your life?
At first, I had a positive outlook on life when I first got out. Then again, I'm looking around, I'm seeing all these protesters in the street, burning flags, cussing up the returning troops. You know, 190 degrees from what you see now, you know. And I guess I can say I'm jealous of the veterans coming back now. I'm proud of them. I'm really proud of them. But I look back what we went through, you know, us just getting on. No respect, Steve. In respect, they were blaming us for the war for some reason, like we started or something. I just don't know what it was. They call it the Wild 60s. Flag burning, race riots. One part I'm glad it's over with. Like I said, I'd much rather be in Vietnam fighting than over here fighting in the streets of Watts, Los Angeles, Newark, Washington, D.C. I wouldn't mind opening up here, but that's one opinion. They were just uncalled for. I think it was spoiled kids. Not really. It's just the way the culture was. Free love. And then went to war. For your time.
Is there anything else you'd like to add that we haven't covered?
No, like I say, I'm glad the last two wars have ended the way they have. Gulf War and this one in Iraq. Hopefully, won't have any more. I'm happy for the returning veterans. Like I say, a little difference in this last war, I think it was 58 casualties. No, 62 casualties so far. And Vietnam is 58,760. That's a little difference, you know.
A little difference.
Yeah, and it's, again, we go back to the POWs and missing in action, MIAs. I think MIAs is down to 1,100, I think. And my opinion on some of the MIAs, they were deserters. Some of them went to North Vietnam. Some of them's in Laos, some of them's in both. That's just a personal opinion. But other than that, I appreciate the time to voice my opinion. Well, I'd ever so humble.
Well, thank you for doing this.
No problem.